High Five record came on, you knew it was a High Five record.
They were great singers. They had great harmony, great dance moves.
The industry never heard that before at that age.
It was a dream come true.
We're on our way up. What can stop us?
The gun went off and shot him in the stomach.
My man was walking one day, and the next day he wasn't.
There was rehab, and there was interventions.
What were we going to do? How are we going to do this?
A group who years ago was at the top of the world now becomes at the bottom of the heap.
Uncompromised. Unrecognized. Unparalleled. Unsung. The story of High Five.
Here's a Yuletide wish come true. Walt Disney World holidays. With so much for you, there's memories to make. So get on your ears, because holiday traditions begin right here.
They were the soundtrack for youthful romance.
They were just a breath of fresh air, because his sound was so unique.
These were teenagers who were on a mission of trying to place themselves into the spotlight of New Jack Swing. All summer long, we've been together,
and I never felt so good. Through the early 1990s, High Five rode straight out of Waco, Texas, to rule the R&B charts.
There had been boy bands before, but you'd never really heard of a boy band from Texas.
High Five was something totally outside the box, like no one expected it.
For the teenage singers, that ride to the top together was a fairy tale to match the starry optimism of their music.
Everything was like, oh man, like they were just in awe of everything.
They had the opportunity to live the dream that a lot of people can only dream about.
But the dream they shared would turn to nightmare as one disaster after the next tore apart their friendships, their careers, and their lines.
He said, your lead singer killed somebody yesterday.
The van rolled over on top of another vehicle, and he kept saying, I can't move, I can't move.
Somebody called me and said, man, I heard about your boy. They found him dead.
It got to the point where I didn't even want to hear the songs on the radio, because what was in the beginning sweet and a blessing switched, and now it was just darkness and tragedy.
Four of the five young singers who would form High Five, Marcus Sanders, Russell Neal, Roderick Pooh Clark, and Tony Thompson, grew up in Waco, Texas, 100 miles south of Dallas, and everything that a big city was not.
We all grew up together, and we kind of knew everybody.
It's a small town. Everybody knows everybody. Sometimes that's good, and sometimes that's not good.
And by the mid-80s, word around Waco was spreading about a 10-year-old prodigy named Tony Thompson.
I found out he could really sing in church. They started a youth choir, and he started singing in the choir.
Churches from all around heard about this little kid that could blow the roof off.
One day he said, "Daddy, when I grow up, I want to be a professional singer. I want to be like Michael Jackson." And I told him, I said, "Well, whatever you put your mind to do, you can do it."
Along with church, Tony began singing at talent shows, where he often competed against a musician named William Walton.
Tony was the victor of all of the shows. And, you know, William being the guy he was, he always said that if I make it first, I'll come back and I'll get Tony.
Walton's music had caught the ear of a New York manager named Vinnie Bell.
And I was talking to William one day, and I told him, "I want a little kid, like a little Michael Jackson kid." And he was like, "Yo, fam, I have the perfect kid for you."
And we went all the way to Waco, Texas. And I heard the kid open up his mouth once, and that was it.
He was singing in a high tenor range like Ralph Tresvant, but he was doing all these gospel runs at 12 years old, and he just blew me away. I knew the kid was amazing.
The plan was to build a teen pop group around Tony in the mold of New Edition, who were dominating the charts in the late 80s.
I asked Tony, "Do you have any friends that can sing anywhere close to how good you sing?" And he said, "Yeah, my friend Toriano Easley."
Toriano Easley had grown up in Oklahoma. With dreams of becoming a singer as well.
Vinnie Bell, he called me and asked me to sing over the phone, and I sung Levert over the phone.
And I had never heard anything like that. A little teenage kid with this grown man soulful voice.
Next in was a top high school athlete and dancer named Russell Neal.
I was always a good background singer, but not a lead singer. My talent that God gave me was dancing. My friends and I, we used to go to this party at the skating rink, and we used to do New Edition, and that's basically how we got girls, and that's how I got discovered.
Two other Waco teenagers completed the quintet, Roderick Pooh Clark and Marcus Sanders.
Tony and I played baseball against each other. I played basketball with Russell and with Pooh as well.
They called their new group the Playmates.
Tony definitely was the shy, youngest one. Russell was more composed, Pooh definitely the hothead one. And I think Toriano and myself, we were pretty much laid back.
I signed them to my entertainment company, and then I did a deal with Job. We had to get it court approved because they're minors, so, you know, it's a little more difficult than if you're signing an adult. But it was really pretty fast.
I was 15, actually, when we first signed. The day that they actually came with the contracts, I hadn't even told my mother that I was in a singing group.
And along with their new recording contract, the Playmates got a new name.
I think Hugh Hefner owns the name, come to find out. So we had to change our name from the Playmates because Hugh Hefner owned it.
We kind of developed this thing where if you say something cool or something that we thought was fly at the time, we would give each other high fives. In the beginning, we used H-I with the Roman numeral V. So I guess someone finally got the light in their head, was like, I don't know if H-I-V would be the best way to go with it. So we finally had to take the V off and put the five with it.
For High Five's album debut, Jive Records sent the group to New York to work with the high priest of New Jack Swing, Teddy Riley.
Like, wow, this is Teddy Riley. I mean, we probably didn't even speak much, you know, we just kind of followed his direction. And Tony, you know, he definitely looked up to him. And when Teddy would compliment what he was doing, it just kind of brought him out even more.
The way she held me in her arms made me feel.
Released in 1990. High Five's first album was a hit out of the box, fueled by an infectious single by Bernard Bell and Teddy Riley, and sung by Tony, called "I Just Can't Handle It."
This girl got a shot out of here.
Tony's voice was magical. The combination of this young ball of talent with this seasoned production of Teddy Riley is just unstoppable.
I Just Can't Handle It became a radio favorite and cracked the R&B top 10 singles charts.
We were all together after rehearsal riding, and we heard it, and we jumped out at the red light, and we danced, and we partied.
Driving down the street, the announcer said, this is a brand new single from the group High Five. I said, what? Hey, that's my brother, that's my brother.
What excuse could I have?
Where were I? I was in jail. Yeah, I was in jail. I was at McLeod in prison.
High Five's first single, I Just Can't Handle It, shot to the top 10 in 1990, accompanied by a video that showcased the young group's rural roots.
So yeah, this is definitely the spot where it began, you know. Suspension Bridge was probably the only place that was, you know, recognizable.
They didn't want it to be no question that these kids are some Midwest kids. From a place like Waco, you see the diner and it says Waco in the little bridge.
And we put ourselves on the map at the Elite Cafe right here.
Yeah.
Just can't handle it.
We was country boys. And a lot of people, you know, were like, wow, how did you be from Waco and make it to New York?
We're thinking to ourselves, we're on our way up. What can stop us?
We had a meeting with RCA Records product manager. And he said, oh, and by the way, your lead singer killed somebody yesterday. And we were like, what?
While visiting friends in Oklahoma City, Tariano easily had gotten into a confrontation with someone he knew there.
When I swung a jab at him, he backed up and was like, oh, you serious? Oh, you want to fight, huh? I'm like, yeah. I pulled the gun out and was like, yeah, let me get my gun to my little homie. And I turned around to get my gun to my little homie. He socked me in the back of the head. When he hit me in the back of the head, he grabbed me. And when he grabbed me, the gun went off and shot him in the stomach.
Tariano, age 17, was charged with first-degree murder and pled guilty to manslaughter.
They gave me 10 years for that, and I ended up doing 6.5.
Now, I remember Tori being a... Being a good guy, you know, he just got caught up in his environment and, you know, made a wrong choice.
I shouldn't have been packing the gun or it wouldn't even happen, you know what I mean? He wouldn't even try to take it. It was just, I had a gun and, you know, so it was my fault for me having a gun.
Now, we could have been finished at that point. And for a while, it began to look as if we were finished.
RCA said, you gotta find a guy to replace this kid. And they put it on the radio that we're looking for a lead singer for High Five. I heard they auditioned like 100 kids and no one had no big Johnny Gill, Gerald LaVert kind of voice. Cause at that age, kids' voice is squeaky and it's changing.
So finally, the management were in New York and they were at a high school function or something. And that's how they came across Treston.
Treston Irby was a high school student and sometime gospel singer who'd grown up in the Bronx. Joining an R&B group wasn't even on his radar.
Nah, I didn't even know nothing about
who High Five was, you know. I was just doing gospel shows in Stevenson High School.
I was coming from school, Stevenson High School, down that way, and I was walking, and this is where Vinnie Bell had his truck, his Jeep. And I got in the Jeep, and he was like, yo, you know, I heard a lot of good things about you. You from here? I was like, yeah, you know, I'm from Bronxdale, actually. He was like, yo, sing me a song, man, sing me a song.
And Trustin sung for me, and I think personally Trustin has a beautiful baritone.
And right in that Jeep is where it all started.
I said, hey, he's the right age. I asked him if he wanted to do it. He said, yeah, I met his mother.
Vinnie Bell just came out and told me he wanted to take my son. And my response to him was, take him where? My son laughed, and he says, well, we like to take him to Waco, Texas. I never heard of Waco, Texas.
2 weeks later, Trustin Irby of the Bronx was on his way to Waco.
Tony was happy in the beginning because he needed another lead to sing off of, you know, so he was happy. I was happy because we wasn't getting dropped.
All summer long, we've been together, and I never felt so good.
Trustin arrived just in time to help High Five promote their next single, co-written by Teddy Riley, entitled I Like the Way. The Kissing Game.
The Kissing Game meant that you made love out of a game of some sort. It was like young love. And not only was it just young love, it was something that everyone could relate to.
You know, honestly, I can't front, man. I played Kissing Game until it was no good anymore.
That was Teddy Riley's so to speak. That's what Teddy did. Music, the way Teddy could put vocals together. It was just that perfect storm.
The Kissing Game rocketed to number one on the pop and R&B charts.
When that song came out, I swear, man, it changed my life. It changed everybody's lives, man. One minute we was here, the next minute it was like, pow.
That same year, I Can't Wait Another Minute became the third single and first ballad off High Five's debut album.
You know how when the Jacksons first came and Mike had that distinguished voice, that's the same way it was with High Five. It was like, oh man, who is this?
Sure enough, I Can't Wait Another Minute became High Five's second straight number one single.
To this day, I mean, I've got people that, you know, tell me, man, I can't wait another minute. I love that song.
High Five had survived their first crisis to emerge stronger than ever. It wouldn't be their last.
And we're driving, and everybody's happy. And the next thing I know, we crashed.
It just began to be tragedy after tragedy after tragedy. My man, we had a stage. Blessed to have this house and have this living room that was just gigantic. We would push the sofa aside and the love seat aside, and man, we had a stage. That's where it all started. We would get at it, and man, we would sweat. She just pulled that carpet up not too long ago, but I know that carpet had High Five sweat in it.
With a gold album debut, the members of High Five were suddenly teenage stars. Too young to be let loose on their own, but old enough to try.
We were all minors. You had to have a guardian with you. So if you think about it, that was 10 people, you know, that had to travel. Of course, we were advised that, look, bring us without the parents, but you can't do that.
I'm like a big brother. I'm no nonsense. So I wasn't going to let them go to after parties and be around older celebrities smoking weed, drinking, and all that.
They couldn't do nothing. They couldn't go anywhere. Oh, man, Tony would be like, Flex, man, y'all going to the club? I'm like, yeah, man. Oh, man, we can't go to the club, dog. I'm like, hey, man, well, you will one day. Don't you worry about it.
It was difficult when you realize, you know, you have so much at the tip of your fingers, but you can't always enjoy it.
We were doing what we were told to do, going where we were told to go, and just showing up. However, we didn't have control.
But High Five vowed to flip the script. For starters, they voted to cut ties with managers Vinnie Bell and Robert Ford and hired their road manager, Jonathan Kinlock, to take their place.
They felt that they wanted to have a sense of freedom because they were signed to a production company. They pretty much managed the budget. They wanted to have more control and a better contract, and they didn't feel that the previous managers were providing that for them.
I looked at it like kids rebelling against their parents. So I understood they wanted a manager more that they can control and do what they want to do. And I think that's basically what they got.
Next, the group took aim at their record label, Jive, for what they felt was unfair compensation.
They were selling a lot of records, but the guys were unrecouped. In other words, they had money that they had to pay to the labels first. That's pretty much the way that the industry is structured.
We've made big money for the record company. We had the number one song in the country. But the average kid who probably had a full-time job at Foot Locker was probably having more money in his bank account and pocket than we were.
Hotel expenses, falling asleep on the phone talking to their boos on the telephone. So the guys would talk all night and run up these hotel bills and incidentals, so the label would pay it. Guess what? That added to the recoupables. And we're not talking about a couple of hundred dollars. We're talking about thousands of dollars.
You always have people saying, you should be a millionaire by now. You know, you have a platinum song, and usually it will get to your head and it'll cause you to react.
Sure enough, as Jive put together a promotional tour for the release of High Five's second album, Russell Neal proposed a new plan of attack.
I said, okay, fellas, I think that we should refuse to go out anymore unless they bring us in, sit us down, and show us where the money is.
It did make sense to say, okay, we should take that route. But I think as we slept on it and we really thought about it, sometimes you have to roll with the punches.
I tried to get Russell to understand, to look at the big picture, that, you know, you're an important part of this group. And look, we can make it right on this second record.
You can't pay me in popularity anymore. You can't pay me with these fancy trips, these nice hotels, and the magazine covers. It's not enough for me.
So when the other members traveled to New York to shoot a video for High Five's next single, She's Playing Hard to Get, Russell Neal was a no-show.
We didn't know what to do. How are we gonna look, High Five, and it's just four of us?
I hired a choreographer, so he actually was in the video at times, dancing with the guys. So if people looked at it to this day, they might think that's the fifth member of the group.
With or without Russell, She's Playing Hard to Get became a huge hit, reaching the top five on the pop and R&B charts.
The song made sense, too. You know, we were obviously having success, and you had those times where she was playing hard to get. And, you know, obviously in our mind, yeah, you shouldn't be that hard, because here we are, High Five.
The song also helped propel High Five's second album, Keep It Going On, into the top 10. So despite Russell's absence, The group vowed to carry on their promotional tour along the East Coast as a quartet.
And we're driving, and everybody's happy. We're all happy this day. And headed on 95, headed to the radio station. And the next thing I know, we crashed.
Someone hit us from behind, and the momentum caused us to roll over.
Everybody got out the van, and I remember saying, "Pooh, come on, get out, car, Pooh, come on." And he looked at me, and he said, "I can't, Kimmy. I can't feel my legs."
And I went over to him, and I remember holding his head. And he was just looking at me like, "Yo, I can't feel my legs, man." And that eye, the face that he gave me, man, was the face that I'm never going to forget, man.
Roderick Pooh Clark would never walk again.
When I got off the phone, I remember going in my room and getting on my knees. And I pray for my man.
High Five's promotional tour for their second album in 1992 turned tragic when a highway crash left Roderick Pooh Clark paralyzed. From the chest down.
It was terrible, man. I didn't stop crying one bit. We stayed in the hospital. We stayed with him.
We stayed about 2 weeks. You know, to try to help him get recovered and keep him in good spirits.
Myself, Marcus, and Tone, we cried millions of nights, man, because we didn't know what we was going to do.
My man Pooh is the one who asked me to come back. He asked me to do it as a favor to him, so I did come back.
And he came to Florida with us, and we finally found the courage to continue.
Performing their smash hit single, She's Playing Hard to Get, from their CD, Keep It Going On, let's party with High Five.
And I think Arsenio was actually the first performance after the accident that, you know, we were able to show our face again. Arsenio showed us a lot of love when we performed, and he allowed us to share with the world through his network, you know, what happened to Pooh, and that we were wishing him to speedy recovery.